Thank you, Mr. Thakkar. Vice President Piramal, Mr. Pradhan, and ladies and gentlemen, this distinguished gallery. We are dealing with perhaps one of the most important events of the 21st century, the developments in Iraq and its impact globally and particularly for the UK. So I divide my talk in three parts. First part would be to describe what is yet the Iraq crisis. And then I want to briefly describe the impact on the global environment. And then speak about the implications for India and what we should do about it. The Iraq crisis does not arise from the brutal takeover of Mosul and Tikrit and other parts of Syria, but from the announcement on 29th June 2014, when the formation of the caliphate was made and Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, one of the most militant of leaders, was declared as the caliph. Essentially, caliph means a successor to the Prophet Muhammad. And there have been caliphs before. Umar was perhaps the most famous of them. And this new caliph, who is now called Caliph Ibrahim, has given a call to all the Muslims of the world, which I think they call as the Ummah, to follow him and to obey him in his declaration of global jihad, which aim, he said, is to Islamize the world. Now, if that acquires any serious momentum, then I think we are going to end up in a world upheaval and violence. And some ways one looks back at the predictions of Notre Dame and Sri Aurobindo. This was predicted after 2014. So we may see a conflagration of great violence if Caliph Ibrahim doesn't cool down. So, therefore, that is the potential crisis that I wish to refer to today. Not only that, the Caliph has said, the new Caliph has said, that for the next 5 years, the target of countries which would come under his control. And I've got a map. Can I see that map, please? The map for the next 5 years is quite ominous. Iraq is only here for all this. And India is called Khorasan. I don't know why it's called Khorasan. They renamed India. And India is also to be a country which is to be occupied and Islamized. Now, this is something which, in those with a long memory, remember. Because Umar also declared that he will conquer India. And he sent his lieutenant who reached this. Who reached Sindh, but in the border of Sindh and Rajasthan, in a rare occasion for Indian history, the Hindus united. Normally, it's very difficult to unite them. It's like bringing so many frogs together in one place, they all jump in different directions. But the two great Hindu dynasties united. One was the Gujarat dynasty called Gujara Pratihara. And the other was a South Indian, more accurately Andhra, dynasty called the Chalukyas. And they united, and the only defeat suffered by Umar army was at the hands of these two. And after that, the further eastward advance of Islam was stopped. And after that, for 400 years, India didn't really face any serious incursion from the West. So, today the question is, if we could do it then, could it do it again? The crisis, as I said, is the call for global jihad. In effect, the aim is to internationalize the Muslim community. We have Muslims in our country who have joined the army or fought against Pakistan or been heroes in battle. But that is precisely what this call is aimed at. That Muslims of India consider themselves as a part of the caliphate rather than as a part of a nation. That is, the national identity of the Muslim is sought to be wiped out in whichever country they are in. And that, in my opinion, is the core of Irag crisis. The success which they have achieved in coming down to the outskirts of Baghdad makes us wonder whether others will capitulate. There are many Muslim countries, like particularly Arab countries, which are amenable to internal revolt. Saudi Arabia is an example. Qatar is almost a compliant state. So the question would be that if the whole of Iraq is taken over by the caliphate, then it would obviously spread to other Muslim countries eastward. But it would also affect the Muslim community in other parts of the world, in other countries. And in all countries of the world, there are core radical Muslim elements who could take advantage of that. Now, the question from there comes, what then precisely is the impact on the global environment? Remember first that Muslim nations produce 85% of the oil in the world. Qatar produces a very big proportion of the gas. And if the caliphate acquires strength, then the whole world is likely to face an international terrorist onslaught. In fact, the pictures which proudly the IS is called and now renamed as the caliphate has put out is the multinational participation in Iraq of Muslims from different countries. In fact, there are two from Tamil Nadu also there. So, maybe they are ex-LGT and they are now unemployed, so they may find it easier to join there. Or they may be Sri Lankan Tamil Muslims also, I can't say. But it has been identified as Indians, United States, UK, Germany, all Muslims of that country have participated in the onslaught from Mosul, Tikrit downwards to Baghdad. Now, what the effect would be that every country, if the local Muslim population becomes infected, or if they are alienated for other reasons, then there would be not only an outslot from outside for every country, But there can be an internal insurgence, which is going to be hard on almost all countries, because the Muslim population don't live in one pocket. They have, in for instance, Europe, they have gone to be to find work, and so they are all over the place. And then, supposing the hardline Islamic theology is preached, Muhammad had said, and this is not so much in the Quran as it's in the Sirah and Hadith, that the world is divided into three parts: Darul Islam, Darul Harab, and what they call as Darul Harab, where Al Taqiyah, money, a contract, prevails. In Darul Islam, the Muslims are in power, in majority. And what is prescribed there is that no other religion would be allowed to develop. You can see this in Saudi Arabia, where we have a large number of Hindu workers there. They are not allowed to build temples in Saudi Arabia. They are not allowed to celebrate Diwali. They cannot even carry a picture of Ramchandraji in their pocket. I got this confirmed by the ambassador of Saudi Arabia in New Delhi. He's a very articulate spokesman of Saudi Arabia, and come to know him well. And he told me yes, because that is Islam. If we are in power, there's no room for anybody else. Now we also find that in majority areas where Muslims are in majority. Take Kashmir, you will find that it becomes impossible for a very large number of Hindus, they call the Kashmiri Pandits, to live there. In fact, the Hizbul Mujahideen actually gave them an ultimatum to leave in 24 hours. And they had to leave 500,000 of them at that. You can find this in Malappuram in Kerala, which is a district, a Muslim majority district. There too you find there is no room for any other religion. You can find it in Tamil Nadu in small enclaves called town panchayats. I don't blame the Muslims because their mind is clear. The Hindus are confused. That's why I'm pointing this out to you. I was telling Mr. Tucker when he was pointing out something that we all suffer from what is called the Arjuna disease. The Arjuna disease is in the middle of the war, he's sitting there and he's wondering whether he should kill his brothers or not kill his brothers, who are standing across wanting to kill him. This confusion in their minds. Muslim mind is clear. Your majority, there is no room for anybody else. Then the second part is Darul Harab, where Muslims are not in majority. And there the prescription for them is that if the majority is amorphous, undisunited, quarreling amongst themselves, then go on pressing for more and more facilities for the Muslim community, till it is possible to convert the majority to Islam. It's a proselytizing religion, of that there is no doubt. So this is what happens in Darul Harab. So in India we find the Muslim extreme leaders, they want one thing at a time after another. First they would want uniform civil code, then they would dump reservations, then they will say, no, you should agree to Sharia. But at the same time, even if you are in a minority, if the majority is united, which I called as Darul Ahad. There, the prescription given to the Muslim community is don't pick a fight because the majority is so strong. This was practiced by Muhammad when he was in Medina, in Makkah, when the Jews outnumbered him. So he made a contract with them. And then he went to Medina and came back with a large army and wiped out the Jews. At that time somebody said, you had a contract with the Jews to respect and have peace. He said that was a temporary contract. It is expired now. So that's what the meaning of Al-Taqiyya is. It's a temporary contract. So in Australia, there is uniform civil code. There is no demand from the Muslim community for a separate personal law and all for Sharia. So, therefore, I want you to tell, just point out to you, that when this, if the Iraq problems grows, the Iraq movement grows, the Caliph starts moving to other states outside. They already moved into Syria, could easily move into Jordan, and then spread eastward. These are some of the things you want to be clear. We are all for secular, you know. We all want brotherhood. We want, in fact, I consider all Muslims of India to be from the same heritage as myself. The DNA proves it. DNA proves for all Indians to be of one. Even the UP taxi driver and Raj Sharma's DNA is the same. I'm ready to prove it at any time. North Indian, South Indian, same DNA. Hindu, Muslim, Christian, same DNA. Brahmin, scheduled caste, also same DNA. This is now published in internationally reputed journals of the world. So therefore, I say that this kind of preaching comes, and we find the moderate Muslim community leaders are not in a position to stand up to this. And the majority leaders pander to the hardliners, what we call as appeasement. Then it makes it very difficult for moderate Muslims to take a stand. This is what happened in the Shahbal case. In fact, after the Supreme Court judgment, large numbers of Muslim intellectuals demonstrated that please don't change the law. Let the Supreme Court verdict remain. But in order to get what is called the vote bank, thinking that somehow the hardline mullah represents the Muslim community, the law was changed. And today we find BJP getting a majority because there is an undercurrent today amongst the Hindu community that we are a majority and we don't count for it. I had predicted to many people that we will get majority. Nobody believed. There would be a problem about 180, 190, 220. But I knew that this, over the years of the UPA politics, had created an undercurrent. It was very silent. In Germany, after World War I, the Social Democrats refused to speak about the national hurt of the Germans after World War II and the insulting and burden and the huge burden imposed on them because of the war. War reparations and so on. As a consequence, a corporal came and spoke an extremist language and he carried. Germany went with him. I am saying to our own people, don't make the mistake of not articulating the hurt in the Hindu community, which has found over the years an extraordinary appeasement. We have to articulate it and see that it remains within the confines of democratic movement. Otherwise, some extremists will come, learn from history, learn from Germany, then any extremist can come and hijack that.
So, I would say, therefore, in order to prevent upheaval and bloodshed for Chinese people, first is, as I said, we have a big Muslim population on the western border, which is Pakistan, Afghanistan. Well, there's Iran also there. Iran is Shia. We may get a new ally called the Shias, but because the movement of Caliph is a Sunni movement. But I would say Pakistan and Afghanistan. Pakistan today has four governments. The civilian government of Nawaz Sharif, the army, the ISI, and the cleric, which is mostly Taliban. And I don't think that the civilian government has much say, because when Narendra Modi invited him to the swearing-in ceremony, all other sub-countries immediately accepted the invitation. But Mr. Nawaz Sharif couldn't accept for 5 days, because he had to get clearance from the other three governments in Pakistan. What my reports suggest about Pakistan is that there's a creeping Talibanism in Pakistan. Some demonstration of that has been shown to you in the airport incident in Karachi. If Pakistan becomes Taliban, and the Americans who have decided to leave Afghanistan and go next year, then both Taliban and Taliban will be in both places, Afghanistan as well as Pakistan. And then I don't think you have any doubt, because the Taliban has already announced that we will attack India. They say it's an unfinished history of Islam. Why is it an unfinished history of Islam? Because when Islam went to Iran, the Zoroastrians were ruling, and in 15 years, Iran was converted to 100% Muslim. In Mesopotamia and Babylon, which is now called Iraq, it took just 17 years. Egypt, it took only 21 years. But here, Muslim emperors were there for spread over almost 800 years. And still, the Hindu population is 80%. So it's an unfinished business. So this is the language they have spoken in their writing. So you have to prepare for that. Even if you don't go to war, they are going to go to war. And therefore, what do we do? I think one of the things we should do is to create effective harmony between Hindus and Muslims. I say the word effective, not appeased unity. I'm happy this time about 17% of the Muslim population voted for Mr. Modi. And I'm happy that in Gujarat, which used to have a communal riot every 3 months, for the last 11 years has not had a single communal riot. It's a tribute to both communities. But somewhere I find there is a distinct difference in approach of the Hindu, of the Indian Muslim community, just as there is in Indonesia, which is also a Muslim country. And somehow we must try to see that they are isolated. But that doesn't mean we don't prepare for the indication of the Iraq crisis, which is prepare for war. We need allies. In my opinion, there cannot be a better ally for us in this fight over a perspective of 5 years than China, which is now also facing Islamic terrorist movement. Uzbekis, Uyghurs are being trained in Pakistan, and through the Karakoram Pass they are getting to Xinjiang, and they are carrying out terrorist attacks in that region. So I have found in my visits to China, I have just come back from China after a World Peace Congress, where I found increasing concern about what will happen to both of us, China and India, if Afghanistan becomes Taliban and Pakistan also becomes Taliban. So one of the things that India could do is to create new alliances. I'm not sure about the United States, because the United States is a country which is based on the principle of cost-benefit analysis. When they find that the cost is more than the benefit, they drop you like hot potato. They did it in Vietnam, they're doing it now in Afghanistan. Whatever, that is their method, but their mind is clear. Again, I compliment them. They have never hesitated to say that this is how we think. I think this is a problem which, like the second Caliph Umar was stopped by an alliance of Rajas within India. I think now there has to be a growing Asian unity in which China and India will have to play a major part. I also think that we need to think of ways of uniting our people. I'm not talking about Hindu Muslims, I'm talking about Hindus themselves. It is not that we not had a unity, but Chanakya spoke about how the whole country will be divided into 600 Janapadas. That is, there were 600 countries in India. But he said, at the time of war, there will be one Chakravarti. We call it the principle of Chakravarti. So you find in all our major wars, country comes together. Mahabharata, every king in India came to participate in that war. Of course, the Pandavas, under the leadership of Lord Krishna, got only 13 kings. Remaining kings, so numbering more than 1,000, were with the side of Duryodhana, which only proves that brain power is much better than brawn power. But the fact is that in every war we have had, it has been always, whether it's Ramayana or the Mahabharata war, when there is an issue of what we call as Dharma Yudha, then the whole country gets involved. So there is a basic unity. And that has been demonstrated in 1962 when the Chinese war took place in the border. In fact, the Chinese leaders themselves expressed surprise to me that the whole propaganda is that this country is not one country, the British have put it together, and one little knock and it will fall apart. And in fact, not the opposite happens. Women used to take off their gold bangles for the National Defense Fund. We have seen that unity in the elections of 1977, of 1984. National unity exists itself whenever there is a great danger to the country. That has to be further identified. I say, therefore, we need now to think in terms of how to develop a national consciousness, what I call as the identity of the Indian. I ask people, what do you mean by an Indian? And in the end, most people say, I have an Indian passport, that's why I'm an Indian. That's not an Indian. You don't have to go to the extreme of the Americans who have defined, Professor Samuel Huntington has defined an American as a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant Christian who speaks English. When it was pointed out to him that in America there are Koreans, there are Indians, there are Chinese and so on, he said, yes, they are American citizens. But an American is a white Anglo-Saxon American, white American who speaks English. Recently, Cameron also said that who is a Britisher? Who is an Englishman? He said, an Englishman is one who is white and Christian. The same question was asked to him. He said, yes, they are citizens. The Hindus in England are citizens. But the identity of England is this. Well, we have less of a problem because 80% is Hindu. But I also go a step forward and say that the DNA now tells me that we are either Hindus or our ancestors are Hindus. And if this concept everybody can accept who is not a Hindu, then we can have an identity for what we call as Hindustan. A Hindustani is one who is either a Hindu or one who acknowledges that his ancestors were Hindus. Not a difficult thing to accept, but there are many hardliners who think that if you accept that, you get too close to the Hindu community, and that would mean losing control over them. We need also to unite our country with a language which is developed, meets the international standards. At the same time, it's an indigenous language. And now I have found that the NASA has adopted Sanskrit as the language for artificial intelligence, the most advanced field of computers. You can see this by going to Google and Googling this. We have a language called Sanskrit whose vocabulary is in every language, even in Tamil. Many years